Oh, thank you so much. It's so great to be here. I am a longtime Evanston resident, and I'm just so proud of our community. I'm also, I have to tell you, the proud mother of two ETHS graduates and now two ETHS grandchildren. Isabel Hart is about to graduate this year, and her sister Lucy is a freshman. So I really feel at home here. Thank you, Principal Marcus Campbell. Thank you, Superintendent Witherspoon. Thank you all the staff and wonderful people who helped make this possible tonight. And congratulations to FAN, the Family Action Network, for this spectacular event and for the great work that you do. I know that FAN represents schools all over the North Shore and some in Chicago, and lots of community partners that are working together, and that's what makes this organization so unique. So this evening, I have the great honor of introducing our Senator Dick Durbin, who will introduce our special guest. But I want to just say a couple of words about our colleague, Cory Booker. I had the pleasure of hearing Senator Booker speak at a remarkable ceremony 2 days ago. The Congressional Gold Medal was presented to the foot soldiers of the 1965 Voting Rights March, marches. And present in Emancipation Hall within the visitor center of the Capitol were about 50 of those veterans of 50 years ago who literally risked their lives for the right to vote. And that was including our dear friend John Lewis, who is a member of the United States Congress and a civil rights hero. So Cory Booker, who is only the fifth African American to ever serve as senator in the United States of America, and let's be clear, two of the others have been here from Illinois, was one of the speakers, and he was truly eloquent. And among the inspiring things he had to say was to thank those foot soldiers for making it possible for him to be a United States Senator, and to point out how much is yet to be done to secure those rights. So I'd like to think that we here tonight are the foot soldiers for our children and our grandchildren, assuring them that they can fulfill their aspirations. So for fighting for new voting rights and restoring voting rights in the United States Senate, along with Cory Booker, is our own senator, who, with all due respect to Senator Booker, I believe is the best United States Senator in the country, Dick Durbin. And you should know that Dick Durbin loves Evanston. It is no accident that he comes to our 4th of July parade as often as he can, because Evanston loves you back, Senator. And for good reason. And to the young and youngish people in this auditorium, you don't remember when smoking was allowed on airplanes. And you may think it's so obvious now that that's a bad idea, but it wasn't so easy to pass legislation when he did it that prohibited it. And that has truly saved lives, not only of people who travel on the airlines, but the flight attendants and those who work on the airlines and have to breathe that toxic air every single day. But that is just emblematic of his career. He got that landmark law passed and really started the ball rolling to limit smoking in all public places. He's fought to make our food safer, Illinois' infrastructure stronger, our education system get more funding, the world more peaceful, by recently leading the fight for the landmark agreement that prevents Iran from having nuclear weapons, and now to help the city and the children of Flint, Michigan, who were poisoned by the water that came out of their faucets. He has legislation that would not only help Flint, but to prevent that kind of, I was going to say tragedy, but that sounds too benign, because it was really neglect that caused that to happen. So Dick Durbin, who holds the second most powerful position in the United States Senate, is always, always leading the way to make our family, our country, and the world better. And one more thing, you will never meet a nicer or more generous guy than my friend, our Senator Dick Durbin.
Well, it's all true. Jan Schakowsky, forgive my voice, but Jan Schakowsky, I've often said that if you have a tough political battle and you get to choose one person to stand by your side, you pick Jan Schakowsky. She is principled, she's courageous, and she is a great friend. Lonnie Stonich, thanks for the opportunity to be here tonight and work, all your work on behalf of the Family Action Network. A special thanks to Dr. Marcus Campbell, who on the way walking in here said, "Oh, I first met you when I graduated from high school." Makes me feel so old. Dr. Witherspoon, thank you. Now, I've been asked to say a few words about my friend Cory Booker. There are a lot of stories I could tell. Here he was, mayor of Newark, New Jersey. And listen to what he did. He saved a dog named Cha-Cha from sub-zero temperatures. He rescued his neighbor from a burning house. And in 2010, shovel in hand, he dug out snowed-in residents of Newark. Now, some have suggested he's not just a politician, he's a superhero. And he just, that might be right. When Hurricane Sandy devastated the East Coast, a lot of people lost power in New York and New Jersey. What did Cory do? He invited them to come to his place to watch DVDs, charge their cell phones, and order lunch. And during the superstorm, he constantly stayed in touch with his constituents, tweeting nonstop, which he still does, I'm probably doing it right now, in an effort to keep everybody updated. But even during the crisis, he didn't lose his sense of humor. When a man from Dublin, Ireland, tweeted him about a, quote, sort of pothole, close quote, Cory responded by putting a spin on Jay-Z's hit song, 99 Problems. And I quote, "Sir, it looks like you live in Dublin, Ireland. I've got 99 problems and your ditch ain't one." Cory Booker is no ordinary politician. And for Senator Booker, deciding on a life dedicated to public service was a choice. He could have done a lot of things. He was an All-American football star at Northern Valley Regional High in Old Tappan, New Jersey. He served as senior class president. He led a student-run crisis hotline. He received a football scholarship to Stanford, a Rhodes Scholarship to study at the University of Oxford. He's a graduate of Yale Law School. His options were unlimited. He chose public service. And for any cynics that think that public service isn't glamorous and not about wanting to help people, let me tell you a story about a young city councilman. The year was 1999 and Cory was 30 years old. Just elected, first term city councilman. The Garden Spires, a housing unit in Newark, was known as the source of a major drug problem, violence, and murder. The president of the Tenants Association got into a heated exchange with this young councilman, asking him, "If you can't help, then why did we elect you? He wasn't sure what he could do as a councilman about drug dealers, but he knew he could bring attention to a problem. So he moved in, not into one of the apartments, but into a tent between the two buildings, and went on a 10-day hunger strike. And it worked. His actions brought attention to a problem that had been ignored for far too long. We need more Cory Bookers in our cities, in our states, and federal government. Recently, Cory said, "Your differences matter, but your country matters more." That shouldn't be controversial. It should be common sense. But common sense ain't what it used to be. And today in Washington, D.C., compromise is a dirty word. People no longer run for office based on bringing people together, but rather on division. Senator Booker's message of unity is refreshing, and we sure need it. His new book presents a new political philosophy, not the empty rhetoric of the past. Right now, I'm personally working with Cory on a criminal justice reform bill, which reforms mandatory minimum sentences to give a sentencing judge more latitude to consider the individual circumstance of each case. It's called the Sentencing Reform and Corrections Act. I worked on this bill starting 3 years ago. When Cory Booker arrived, the whole scene changed. There was a new energy in this effort. He calls me regularly, texts me more often. I believe he tweets me, but I haven't quite figured that part out. Keeping on this issue almost every day and every weekend. And I want to thank him for making criminal justice reform a top priority. We aren't fighting this battle alone. We have actually, surprise, surprise, have some Republican support for this. We hope to get it passed. There's an old saying that Senator Booker adopted, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Let me close with this. Recently, there have been articles mentioning Cory Booker as a possible nominee to fill the vacancy on the U.S. Supreme Court. Upon seeing the articles, he immediately sent them to his mother and said, "Behind every successful child is an astonished parent." Well, after everything he's already achieved, his mom is pretty well astonished. I don't know what's next for Cory, but I do know this. Everybody in the Senate loves him. That's common ground we all share. And as city councilman, mayor, U.S. Senator, Cory Booker has and will continue to advance the common good. Join me in welcoming to Evanston Township High School my friend and colleague, Cory Booker.
Wow. Wow. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. All right. So let me tell you something right now. Dick Durbin is probably one of the greatest United States senators, not now, but in the modern history of the United States Senate. But now I know you just can't believe everything he says, because that was overly gracious, overly kind. And I just want to tell you from my perspective, I got elected in a special election. Senator Lautenberg, the sort of legend in New Jersey, he passed away. So there was a sudden election. And I got won the election and literally went from being a mayor to a United States senator in a brief period of time. It was almost a blink of the eye, because there was no long month or two. It was, hey, you just won, get down to the Senate and get sworn in as soon as possible. And it just so happened that the day I landed on was the auspicious day, the very honorable day of Halloween. And Joe Biden, who has a great sense of humor, and he literally has mastered my favorite kind of humor, which is dad humor. I thought he was going to mess up my name, you know, just for fun, call me Cory Booker. But he did not. He played it straight. And I got sworn in. And when I went down and senators come over and shake your hands, I want you to know that the biggest thing on my mind was that I just came from Newark, New Jersey. And I'm the mayor of the biggest city in the state. I was before I swore my oath. And it was a tough stretch. We had a period of about 10 murders in 10 days. The last young man, Rajan, is somebody that I think about all the time in the Senate. We have kids that die every day in our country. It's a routine reality of putting children in boxes now. And so I'm the 21st American in the history of our country since 1789, the 21st to go straight from being a mayor to being a United States senator. And so I was very happy to be the mayor the senator from New Jersey. As Jan said so beautifully, we've only had five popularly elected senators in the history of our country, only five. And you all are responsible for two of them in this state, so that's pretty darn impressive. But after Edmund Brooke then was elected popularly, then Carol Moseley Braun, then Barack Obama, and I was number four, followed by Tim Scott, number five. And as I stood on the Senate floor, I have to say, I still felt this sense of mission, because we are a nation that has a criminal justice system that belies exactly what I saw going up the Capitol steps. You turn around and you see the Supreme Court and it says equal justice under law. And I just knew that was not true, because I would go to, as I'll tell you a little bit more in a moment, I went to Stanford University and there was a whole lot of drugs used on college campuses. But nobody was being stopped and frisked on the way home. They weren't raiding dorms. In fact, there's no difference in America between blacks and whites and Latinos for using drugs. In fact, there's no difference between blacks, whites, and Latinos for dealing drugs, except for the fact some studies show a little bit higher rates for dealing drugs for young white men. And so I came from a reality, though, when I moved to Newark, that this war on drugs was not really a war on drugs. I realized it was a war on people, and that it was particularly a war on poor people and a war on minorities, with African Americans about 3.7 times more likely to be arrested for doing drugs or dealing drugs than someone's white. And then when you get caught, you get about a 20% longer sentence just based on the color of your skin. And so I came knowing that this was destroying my community, and I came with a mission to make sure that I wanted to do something about this. And so when I got to the Senate, the guy who was at the center of an effort to end this mass incarceration, to end the shameful sin of this country, this cancer on the soul of our nation, where we have 5% of the globe's population, but 95% of human beings live outside of America, but one in four of the imprisoned people on the planet Earth are in the United States of America. And this is not a black problem, a white problem, Latino problem. This is our problem because we spend trillions of dollars locking people up. Other nations, and this trend, you should know this, we have been going down in percentage of our GDP that we invest, going down in the percentage of GDP that we invest in things like infrastructure, down in higher education, medical research. Other countries around the globe, they still get it. China spends four times the percentage of their GDP on infrastructure, Europe twice what we spend. They are passing us with the speed of their trains, the efficiency of their ports. And yet in America, though, we belie that in one area of infrastructure investment, where we leave the world behind. Between 1995 and 2006, we were building a new prison in this country about every 11 days. We take on this burden, this tax burden, instead of investing in our schools or our bridges and tunnels, allowing those to decline, we're happy to invest in prisons. And so for me, as a guy who came and saw this devastating world where we don't invest in our children as much as we should before they get in trouble, Frederick Douglass said it so clearly, and you all know it's easier to build strong children than to heal broken men. I came to the Senate with a sense of urgency on this issue. And so when I met Dick Durbin, who I only knew from TV, the first time I shook his hand, I had only known him as this guy I would watch on TV from time to time, and told him about my passion and the sense of urgency I felt. You know, the Senate cannot always be a collegial place as much as we think it is. And sometimes people are very, very... Thank you for getting the joke there. You know, sometimes senators are very protective of their turf, but this is a guy who said to me, come on, we're gonna do this together, and join me right away in the fight. Suddenly I was not only a part of the effort, I was in the huddle. I was in the scrum of trying to get this done. And I'll never forget this moment. This shows you the humility of him. Is the president, who's turning more and more to this issue, he calls this summit at the White House. And, you know, I'm still one of those guys that still walks around that place still getting chills. I'm like, you know, this is, wow, look at this. You know, I'm in the Situation Room. And then, you know, what's the situation? You know? And I'm getting excited. And the other senators, you know, just walking around. But I'm like, wow, we're in the White House, you know? And I'm walking in the White House, and I'm like, Cory Booker. And so we sit down, and there's all, again, legends are sitting around this table. People like Patrick Leahy and just chairmen of committees, and the president has called a summit at the White House, and I'm quiet. You know, my role as a freshman backbenching senator, just quiet, you know, and just take it all in. The president's sitting over there, vice president's here. Of course, Dick Durbin is Dick Durbin, so he's sitting right there as the second most powerful guy in the Senate. And everybody's, the big chiefs are going around the table to talk about what's important. And it gets to Dick Durbin, and he starts talking about the issue, and he starts talking about me, calling me out in front of the president as this is the guy that's trying to make this happen, and just starts lifting me up and elevating me. And so there's this definition of faith that I have. That I hope that you all agree with me that this definition of faith is very accurate. The definition of faith is that when you come to the end of all the light you know, and you're about to step into the darkness, faith is knowing one of two things is going to happen. One is that you're either going to find solid ground underneath you, or two is that the universe will send you people that will teach you how to fly. I've been in the Senate for 2 years. I've been in the Senate for the 2 years and have been able to be a part of things and get things going and get things moving because I've found mentors who care about me as a person and who've elevated me to do big things. And I just want this state to know you all have an incredibly special man who was a United States Senator, but more importantly, he's been a mentor and a friend to me, and I just want to say thank you to him right now. Enough of that. He'll never leave me alone in the Senate gym now. You look at the two of us and you go like, you guys go to the Senate gym? Yes, we do. You guys are harsh. I don't know if your constituents come up to you like this. They're like, hey, Cory, you're gaining weight, aren't you? People are too honest with me. Your congresswoman, let me tell you why, like this is, speaks volumes. Notice people when the cameras aren't on, what they do. So your congresswoman, she comes in tonight in the little holding room. I greet your congresswoman, so good to see her. And she sits down and she turns to me and she pulls out a file folder. And she's like, we got some work to discuss. And there's like all these people around and she starts going over legislation with me. I'm like, it is Friday night. Do you ever take time off? So that's the kind of person you have as your congresswoman. So good that she would spend part of Shabbat with me. Thank you very much. God bless you. And then the last thank yous I just want to say is to the leadership of this school, to the teachers and the faculty and the staff, your principal and your superintendent. This school is nationally known for doing things that people say can't be done in public education. You are showing a way forward for this country. You are a light unto this nation. And I just want to say thank you for bringing me here and allowing me to learn more about this great institution. All right. So, real quick, I just want you to know that I'm thrilled to be here, and I want to have a conversation. I'm going to talk for a little bit, but I'm really interested to hear from you, so I'm going to try to manage my time wisely so we can have a conversation. When I was running for Senate, I left Newark, New Jersey, and now I'm running around the state, and I was surprised that everywhere I went, from our wealthiest towns to our poorest cities, from our rural areas, everybody seemed to have a question for me, and they were lamenting the fact about how divided our country was, how can we get big things done anymore? I heard it time and time and time again. I heard frustration. I sometimes heard cynicism and worry about this nation and our divisions. And it wasn't just our politics. Sure, I heard about it, like, why can't Congress get anything done? What's going to make you different? How are you getting things done? But I also heard about our media. I heard about the conversations we have with each other. I heard it about people who say that they read articles about me online and then they get to the comment section. Somebody laughs because they know what I'm talking about. They suddenly encounter the most vicious, acerbic, mean statements they've ever seen. They wonder what's happening to a country that has such commonalities, but yet we don't manifest them in our world. And it spoke to me because my experiences in my life are 100% different than this. In fact, if anything, I began to reflect on my journey and I began to think, wait a minute. I have this saying where I say I got my BA from Stanford, but my PhD from the streets of Newark. And the humble heroes who may not have many degrees, but showed a wisdom and a brilliance that inspired me. I said, wait a minute, the teachers and the folk I've met on my journey, especially when I stepped out of my comfort zone into the darkness with faith, I found people who gave a testimony to something different. And the more I thought about this issue about our divisions, the more I got upset. Because I think that our history, the best of who we are, speaks to something dramatically different than the reality we all lament right now. This nation was formed differently than any other country. Most countries at the time in the 1700s were formed because of commonalities. The people were the same, spoke the same language. They had the same faith. They were theocracies. We were a nation that was formed out of difference. People coming from lots of different places on the planet Earth. And I'm not one of these people who wants to homogenize and whitewash and make pretty our history. I'm one of these guys that wants to talk about the wretchedness and imperfections of our history. Look, we have a nation that our founding documents, as much as we want to say they're vaunted perfection, no, our founding documents had faults in them. Women were not referred to at all. Native Americans in our founding documents were referred to as savages. Stokely Carmichael used to always say constitute, constitute. I can only say 3/5 of that word because black people were referred to as fractions. But the spirit of those documents, the ideals that we were put forth, we were this nation founded in perfect ideals, but a savagely imperfect reality. But the beauty of the American spirit is that every generation worked to perfect this union. Every generation worked to make more real the promise and the hope of this country. And there was an understanding even amongst the founders. If you read that Declaration of Independence, this independence idea, deep within that document is a declaration of interdependence, this understanding that we need each other. At the bottom of that document, go to it tonight, because it's a beautiful sentiment. We pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, our sacred honor. It was an understanding that we can't do this alone. I love the ideals of self-reliance and rugged individualism in our country. They're important principles. But please know this, rugged individualism did not get us to the moon. It didn't map the human genome. It didn't even pave our roads and bridges. It's because despite our differences, we found a way to join together, creating uncommon coalitions to achieve things that were uncommon in all of humanity. Senator Durbin said it. That African parable is that African phrase is so powerful. If you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. We have gone far as a country because of our bonds. And every religion and every faith and every ethnicity celebrates this ideals of unity. I spent a lot of time studying the Torah, and during the high holidays, there's a song sung, Ki Beiti Beit Tefillah L'Chocho Ami, my house be a house of prayer for many nations. And the Christian faith is whatever two or three are gathered together, he is in the midst. It's this idea of coming together that makes us strong. And I loved during the Crown Heights riots, when blacks and Jews were fighting. Mayor Dinkins, African-American mayor, first in New York, goes to see the Lubavitcher Rebbe and says, hey man, we've got to come together. We've got to figure out a way to bring our two communities together. The Lubavitcher Rebbe looks at the mayor and says, no. And the mayor's sort of surprised by the answer. And Lubavitcher Rebbe says, no, we've got to find a way to bring our one community together. Now, the congresswoman said it. I imagine me, again, I get these moments every week, if not every day in Washington, where I'm doing something suddenly where I have to just stop and try to let gratitude be my gravity, because I'd get carried away with all this stuff. If I didn't pause for a second and just say, thank you, you know, I just feel this gratitude. And this was one of the moments this week that she mentioned. I am standing on a stage with a senator far senior to me, Senator Sessions from Alabama, and he and I had joined together to be the Senate side sponsors of giving the Congressional Gold Medal, the highest civilian honor from Congress, to foot soldiers in the civil rights movement. And I get to go up to a podium and give honor to these men and women who fought, struggled, and marched on the Edmund Pettus Bridge to fight for voting rights. And I'm looking down at John Lewis and other heroes. Now, that was a big moment for me because I know that I didn't get to where I am on my own. You know, my mom and my friends, when I was coming down to the Senate, they took me. The first thing they did, my mom conspired with my staff. They said, before you go see Harry Reid, you are going to go see John Lewis. And so my mom takes me to see John Lewis right before I get sworn in. Now, this is my mother who like, you know, I really wonder if those halls of Congress ever saw a situation like this. I don't know what it is about the power of moms that they can make you. I'm like 40-something year old man at that point, and she's making me feel like I'm 10 going away to camp, you know? She's reflexively saying, now straighten your tie, comb your hair. I'm like, Mom, I don't have hair anymore. And she's like, remember this, remember that. She's like, remember, the title does not make the man. The man has got to make the title. Don't forget, remember who sent you here. It wasn't some appointment from on high, it was the people in the grassroots. She kept saying this, remember, so we're walking through these hallways and I'm wondering, like, did LBJ's mom do this to him? But you see, this didn't start when I got sworn in on Halloween 2013. This is the story of my life. You all think I'm crazy, but this is the story of my life. My parents were drilling into me as a child. I'm walking around my house. I don't care what teenager goes to this high school. I've met some great high school students in the short time I've been here tonight, but none of the teenagers in this high school have the kind of high school teenage swagger that I had. I would walk around my house. I'm Cory Booker, you know, on my way on a football scholarship. I got into Stanford because of a 4.0, 1600, 4.0 yards per carry, 1600 receiving yards. High school All-American football player. The older I get, the better I was. And I would walk through my house and my dad would see me going around in the fridge and he would just, I'd stop and he'd be looking at me. I'd go, what, dad, what? And he'd get mad at me. He'd go, boy, don't you walk around this house like you hit a triple. You were born on third base, young man. And he would put it to me and help me to realize that my generation of Americans, we drink deeply from wells of freedom and liberty and opportunity we did not dig. We sit under the shade of trees that we didn't plant. We eat lavishly from banquet tables prepared for us by our ancestors. And my dad would say to me, you could take all these blessings and just consume them, but you can't just sit back and get dumb, fat, and happy. You've got to let these blessings metabolize in your body so that you can continue the fight. You can't pay those folks back. You got to pay it forward. And so my parents would go through their stories from their childhood and I would hear them all. And they would, my mom would tell me stories and I'd love listening to her because she had this penchant for accuracy and detail. I'd hear the same stories over and over again, but I'd learn a new fact every time she talked. And my dad, I love listening to him tell the stories over and over again because every time he'd tell a story, he had the penchant for hyperbole and exaggeration. And the stories got more dramatic every time he talked about them. You know, he would say to me, son, I was born poor. But if he was here right now, he would yell and heckle me and say, boy, don't you tell those people I was born poor. I was just Poe, P-O, I couldn't afford the other two letters. And so here I am, just a few days ago, standing in front of John Lewis, and it means something to me because when my family's history was made real to me by parents, all they had to overcome, they made a point to me that I am, that we are the physical manifestations of a conspiracy of love. Now, let me be very specific. I had this experience where in a chapter in the book, I start the chapter off, it may not sound like me, because I start the chapter off these words, I hate Henry Louis Gates. Now, I don't hate anybody, and I love Henry Louis Gates. He's a dear friend of mine. But he did something to me that you all get understand why it was bothersome to me. Because he calls me up, and he says, Cory Booker, I've got this show. It's called Finding Your Roots. And I'm like, oh, I know the show, Skip. I said, you want me to come to a premiere? Because he does people like Oprah and Chris Rock. And I'm like, I want to watch. I want to be the front row. Put me next to Oprah. But he's like, no, you don't understand. It's better than that. And I'm like, what is it? And he goes, Cory, I want you to be on the show. And I'm like, me, Skip, me? And he's like, yeah, of course you. You're this great rising star. And he just starts feeding that ego of mine. You're this up and coming politician. Of course you should be on the show. I want to do a show about politics. So you're one of the guys. And I'm like, yeah, I'm one of the guys. And then he just keeps building me up. And then I suddenly realize that he partners two people together. And so I say to him, well, Skip, this sounds like a great show. Who are you going to partner me with? And he goes, and he says it slowly because he knows what it's going to do to me. He goes, well, I'm partnering you with John Lewis. And I'm like, I just paused, and he didn't say anything. The phone was dead for a little while. And then he said it again. I'm partnering you with John Lewis. Now, you have to understand why that bothered me. Because that's like having a show where you partner Superman with Jimmy Olsen. And I knew exactly what was going to happen. I anticipated in that moment, I knew what was going to happen. That the show would basically, I'd seen the show before, so I knew they had to tell the biographies of the people, right? And so this is, in effect, how the show began. It starts off with this splendiferously voiced announcer. They start off, John Lewis, hero of the civil rights movement, marching on the Edmund Pettus Bridge. He stared down hate with love, violence with peace. He was gassed, billy clubs beaten. He split his head. He literally bled the southern soil red for freedom. Now my introduction. Cory Booker, riding his big wheel in suburban New Jersey. He takes a turn too hard, he falls off, he skins his knee. He bleeds the northern soil red for big wheel riders everywhere. My parents wanted me to understand that we in this generation, we come from a mighty history. And it's not the great man theory of history, where somehow these incredible men came down from on high on Mount Olympus to lead us, King, Washington, Lincoln. My parents said that is a wrong understanding of history. And if you think history is that way, it will disempower you to fulfill your responsibilities. Because change in this country has always come from ordinary people doing extraordinary things in the call of our country. My father basically told me the story of being his youth, and again, I tried to filter out the exaggerations. My father, I was afraid to go to North Carolina as a boy because it was always thundering and storms coming, and the storms got bigger and bigger. And then one day he started a story saying, son, when the tsunami hit our town, and I'm like, thou shalt honor thy mother and father. It's a Ten Commandment, but I couldn't let this one go. I'm like, Dad, you're in the mountains of North Carolina. There's no way a tsunami could have hit the town. And I don't know if you have parents like mine, they're indignant if they're challenged. My father's like, boy, it was a long time ago before the internet. You can't look it up, but it happened. But so filtering that out, this is what I know is the truth, is that my father was indeed born poor to a single mother. In fact, Henry Gates traced it all back from slavery, single mother poverty, single mother poverty, single mother poverty. And my dad's there. And his mama couldn't take care of him, and he was taken in by his grandmother. His grandmother couldn't take care of him. So he was then taken in by the conspiracy of love. People in that town refused to let him fail. Strangers, you know, through Skip Gates' work, I found out a lot about my family connections. I was shocked by the blood connections I found out through Henry Louis Gates. I mean, he did some amazing work. My grandfather was born a lot lighter skin. On my mother's side, a lot lighter skin than her siblings. They always wondered if he had a white parent. Well, he went back to Louisiana and with a little cheek scrape, literally found a white family that was my mom's first cousin, because they both shared a grandparent. And I wish I could have been there when they informed them exactly, you have a black branch of your family, guy up in New Jersey. We all met and it was an amazing reunion. This idea that I could have just walked past folk and they could be my family. But as powerful as these blood ties are that we have that we don't realize we have, is these spiritual ties. When my father was taken in by the family, raised up, he didn't think about college. And I know this is lots of stories of families in this room. And there was people in this community that said, you're going to go to college, and they set him on the right path. And they basically said, you're going to go. And he's like, I can't afford to go. And they're like, well, we're going to take a collection in church so you can afford your first semester's tuition, then get a job. I don't know what the ROI is on those people that put money in that church collection plate. And I know Senator Durbin thinking to himself, gosh, we need to bring those days back that a semester's tuition could fit in a collection plate. You should hear him talk in caucus about this issue. But what's the ROI on those people? That spiritual connection. Then my parents get down to Washington, to my mom to Fisk University, my dad to North Carolina Central, to historically black colleges, and they witness thousands of people pouring into the South, black and white, Christian, Jewish, Muslim, coming down for the civil rights movement, another conspiracy of love. Then they get to Washington, D.C., and I don't care what your background is, Jewish, Irish, a woman, most of us, there was a time that corporate America didn't want to hire you, but yet there was organizations in Washington, D.C. made up of blacks and whites that were fighting to get companies to hire their first blacks. And guess what? My parents, college-educated African-Americans, because of the work of others, got their shots at jobs with companies that never hired blacks before. My dad was the first salesman for an oil company, first black salesman, first black buyer for a department store. Then he became one of IBM's first black salesmen ever. Then they get moved up to New Jersey, and amazingly, they find that Bergen County, or northeasternmost county, 70 towns, there's only three of them that we let blacks move into. It's 1969. And so what do? They got the conspiracy of love. The Fair Housing Council, a storefront operation, blacks and whites, folks decided to get together and fight this. And so they set up a sting operation. My parents would go to a house, they would find out it was sold. They would walk away, the white couple would come right up, it was still for sale. Surprise, surprise. My parents loved this one house, but they were told it was sold. They leave, the white couple finds it still for sale. The white couple puts a bid on the house for my parents. The bid was accepted. They asked for the contracts to be drawn up. They were. They set a date for the closing. But instead of the white couple showing up, my father showed up and a volunteer lawyer. Now they walk into the real estate agent's place, and they walk in, and the real estate agent is surprised. Hello, guess who's coming, not to dinner, but to buy a house? and they go up to the man, the lawyer starts in on a great speech, but my father said he barely got into it before the real estate agent stands up and punches my dad's lawyer and sigs a dog on my father. Horrifying. And I have to be honest with you all that every time my dad would tell the story, the dog would get bigger. It went from like Toto to Cujo in the span of like 10, 20 years. Soon it was a pack of wolves. But this was how we moved into Harrington Park, New Jersey, the town I grew up in, as my parents called us, my father would call us the four raisins in a tub of sweet vanilla ice cream. And so you understand now why my dad is sitting in the kitchen table watching me walk around the house and thinking to himself, who is this man who thinks he's got so much swagger? Now, for the book, I decided that I had to go back and research all these stories. And I needed to find the facts. I wanted to go back in time, research everybody. After watching what happened to nice Dr. Ben Carson, I said, I can't have any stabbings in my book unless I have other people that were there. I love Dr. Ben. Pray for the brother. Love him. This Republican primary has been making me pray a lot, Senator Durbin. And so I decided to go back and I interviewed everybody. I went back to the high-rise public housing projects that I lived in at the end, and I'll explain that in a second. I found a lot of the guys who dealt drugs in my neighborhood. I actually waited for one guy to get out of prison so I could interview him. I've tracked down the kingpin that ran my block, and I'll explain this in a second. But I interviewed these guys, got them all on tape. The drug kingpin was gracious to give me all his thoughts. He's now served time in prison. He's now out, he's got a different job. And he just says to me, son, he tells me all these stories that were great, made the book so much better, especially when he told me he had to intervene when I first moved onto the block and tell the young drug dealers not to shoot me. And I got a little scared. I said, really? He goes, no, don't worry about it. They were just going to shoot you in the leg. It was just going to be a warning shot, Cory. Don't worry about it. I'm like, Jace, thank you for that, I guess. But I decided to go back I had to check this story. You know, I had to see, was it a dog or a pack of wolves? I had to make sure which one it was. And so I call up people now, 40 years since that moving in, and I find out that one, the head of the Fair Housing Council, back in the 1960s, African-American woman named Lee Porter, is still the head of the Fair Housing Council now at 90 years old. And she, it's an amazing woman. I send a car for her to pick her up, bring her for an interview, and I just getting teary-eyed as I'm listening to how many families did she change the destiny of? Then I decide to say, okay, well, who are these lawyers that were representing families like mine? And I call up a guy, 84 years old, Arthur Lessman, get him on the phone. Mr. Lessman, I'm Cory, I know who you are. You're my senator. Sounded very proud when he said that. And I go, do you know the role you played in I know the role I played. And I said, sir, I just have to ask you, as he told me more about his life, he was a young lawyer at the time, just starting out. He Arthur Lessman had a partner named Leo, was a Christian and a Jewish man. They joined together. They were just doing home clothes and struggling to make it. And I said, well, why would you do it at the beginning of your career when things were so tough? Why would you do that? And he said, well, look, it was a Monday that I made the decision. And I'm like, sir, that was 40 plus years ago. How do you know it was a Monday? And he said, Cory, you need to understand something. I know it was a Monday because the day before was Bloody Sunday. And I watched these young people on Edmund Pettus Bridge. I got chills when I heard that. Now think about this. I already told you we're a lot more, Skip Gates taught me, we're a lot more connected. You walk past people every day. They could be black, you could be white, and you may be related. But those bonds are not as strong as the spiritual bonds that tie us. Because think about this. Did that person on that bridge know that the instant that they stood up there on that bridge, they would unlock a change of events that would affect generations yet unborn, that it would start this chain where they would do that, they would change the lives of two young lawyers just starting out, make them think, hey, we gotta do something for the civil rights movement, we can't go to Alabama, so let's do what Americans have done for generations, let's do the best we can with what we have, where we are, for the cause of our country. They helped a family move into a town, and I would not be standing before you right now had that not happened. And I tell you all this to begin for the context that I want to put in your thoughts right now, which is we tend to look at this world and see things going on TV in the larger civic spaces, and some of us, it tends to make us cynical about this world. Now, I think cynical is a spiritually toxic state of being, that it clouds out your ability to see faint hope and possibilities amongst glaring problems. The people who turn to cynicism throw up their hands and say, there's nothing I can do about the problem. I've come to say that cynicism is a refuge for cowards. That we come from a history where people who would never see the end of slavery, but they still believed we would be a nation one day free. People who never lived to see women with the right to vote, but they believed that one day we would be a country of equal voting rights. people who saw sweatshops and child labor who met and organized way before we even had breakthroughs in union organizing, and they not only lost their livelihoods, many of them lost their lives, they never surrendered to cynicism despite that opposition. And here we are, Americans in our generations, with such comforts and convenience unimagined by generations before, and we're indulging in cynicism? James Baldwin, one of the most honest, raw writers who confronted the wretchedness and unfinished business of our country, one of my favorite books of all times is The Fire Next Time. At the end of this book, I'm kind of like sobered by what I read, and then at the end of the book, he starts talking about healing this country in a way that some literary critics criticized him. They called him Pollyannish, but no, he was being hopeful when he said, I know what I'm asking you is impossible. But one is, after all, emboldened by the spectacle of human history in general, and American Negro history in particular, for it testifies to nothing less than the perpetual achievement of the impossible. And he said, if we, the truly conscious whites and the truly conscious blacks, can come together like lovers. I want to stick to that word for a second. You see, I believe that we have gotten to this point in our culture where we're heralding the idea of tolerance as if this is some great way to be. We're going to be a tolerant society as if that's some great achievement. I preach intolerance because I don't want us to be a tolerant. That's a floor. But we were not called as a country to be tolerant of one another. Tolerance says, I'm just stomaching your right to be different. And if you disappear off the face of the earth, you're no better or worse. I'm no better or worse off because I was just tolerating you in the first place. We didn't get here as Americans because we were tolerating each other. We're getting here because we were called to something higher that I call and you call love. Now, let me understand, that's a dangerous word for a politician to stand up here and talk about love. Durbin has not let me to the Senate floor yet to give speeches about love. But I want to explain myself. You see, tolerance versus love, to me, it's clear. Love recognizes that I need you. You see, love, we say it in different words. We say patriotism. Now, sometimes in our political context, patriotism is used as a way of saying, I'm so much better than you. I'm more patriotic than you. You're not a patriot. I'm a patriot. But that's not what patriotism is. Patriotism is love of country, which to me necessitates a love of other Americans, even folk that are really different than you. And if you live this idea of love going beyond tolerance, you see that I need you. My destiny is wrapped up in your destiny. That we share value, and that when we create lines of connection between each other, those cords, when that love is made manifest, add great strength to the larger tapestry that is our country. Now, I want to tell you this right now. We criticize things on TV, criticize things in the political space, but we fail to understand that we have the power to connect things. The folks that worked at the Fair Housing Council, they had power and they demonstrated. The folks that were in a small town in North Carolina that put dollar bills in a collection place, they showed and they demonstrated their power. Alice Walker said the most common way we give up our power is not realizing we have it in the first place. And so the question is, if we know that human history is not the great man theory of history, where we have to wait to see what the next president's going to do, what the next senator's going to do, and hope that they maybe will change things, there's one choice we have to make every single day when we see things in the world is to ask ourselves, will we accept things as they are, or will we take responsibility for changing them? And people who take responsibility are those that don't allow their inability to do everything to undermine their determination to do something. And so, God, that's the question. What are we willing to do in the cause of our country? I look at the young men who stormed beaches in Normandy or ran up Mount Suribachi or John Lewis, who got on buses to do freedom rides, knowing that they would be bombed, did marches, knowing he would get beaten. I'm not going to be called to that level of courage. But can I be doing things in my life now, doing something? Now, Senator Durbin talked about a time that I was ready to quit politics. The challenging part of that story for me is I'm embarrassed. I write that story in the book about a sense of shame because I was so gung-ho thinking I was going to change the world. And Newark was constantly teaching me, you need to come correct, young man. Because you don't yet understand the depth of love. Look, I'm going to tell you the truth. When I came out of Yale Law School, I hadn't quite lost my swagger. Okay? I'm Yale Law School. Come on now. My father would look at me and say, boy, you got more degrees in the month of July, but you ain't hot. He would dog me out, thinking I'm fancy degree. Come on, boy. Look at this. You didn't graduate here magna cum laude or summa cum laude. You just, thank you, Lottie. I'm out of here, man. But despite my parents trying to keep me on the ground, I decided that I was going to answer the call of a great American prophet that we study at these fancy universities named Chris Rock. And Chris Rock had this joke. He said, why is it the most dangerous street in every city is named after the man that stood, or the most violent street in every city is named after the man that stood for nonviolence? And so I decided to move onto Martin Luther King Boulevard. And by the way, it's a great street in Newark, even in the mid-90s, had incredible sections that were extraordinary, but the south end of that street was one of the most dangerous streets in the state. And I move in there with all my swagger, and immediately I get knocked upside my head. I'm moving stuff with my best friend from fourth grade, this 6'8" man. We're big guys, we're loading, we come back to my car and my stuff is stolen. And this street had drug dealing like I'd never seen before. And I'll explain this in a second, but I looked over and I saw these menacing guys staring back at me. And we looked at each other and we didn't call the police, we didn't say nothing, we just kept moving. But I was determined, he left, I'm living on that street now, and everybody told me that across the street in these high-rise buildings is the tenant president, she's one of the leaders of this community, you gotta meet her, and her name is Miss Virginia Jones. And I went up to her room, I knocked on that door like I was John Wayne riding into town to help her out. And I think when she opened the door, she said, who are you? I said, Cory Booker, little filly. How can I help you, ma'am? And that's what I was. That was my rap. I moved into the neighborhood as if that was some great accomplishment itself. I moved into the neighborhood, and now I'm here to help you. And she could not be bothered with me. She was looked annoyed with me. She's like, I sort of pushed myself into her apartment, sat down trying to give her my pitch about how I was going to make a difference, and she's just barely listening to me. The phone would ring, and she wouldn't even look eye contact. She'd just start talking, yelling out things, and put it down, and sifting through papers. And I felt like I was on some kind of job interview with somebody that was barely interested in even having a position open. And I thought that this was an interview, and I'm failing an interview, and I'm Cory Booker. I don't fail interviews, for crying out loud. But she just seemed tough and gruff. And finally, after conversations, she invited me to go to Martin Luther King Boulevard. So we went down the 5 flights of stairs, through the lobby, through the courtyard, standing in Martin Luther King Boulevard. And this is what I mean that I got my BA from Stanford and my PhD on the streets of Newark. This woman turns around and says, on Martin Luther King Boulevard, tell me what you see around you. I said, what? She goes, describe what you see. And I said, okay, I see a crack house, I see the projects, graffiti. I just started describing the neighborhood. But the more I talked, the more this 5 feet tall senior citizen woman, the more she looked just frustrated and even angry. And I finally stopped and she said, well, you can't help me. And she turns around, she starts walking away, marching away from me. I ran after her and I grabbed her, very respectfully, mind you. And I'm like, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? And she looks at me hard and she says, boy, you need to understand something. The world you see outside of you is a reflection of what you have inside of you. And if you're one of these people who every time you open your eyes, you see problems, darkness, and despair, that's all there's ever going to be. But if you're one of those stubborn people who every time you open your eyes, you see hope, you see opportunity, you see love, you see the face of God, then you can be one of those people that helps me. And she turned around, walking away, leaving me looking at my feet, thinking to myself, okay, grasshopper, thus endeth the lesson. But I tell you, I went back with a whole lot of humility. I came correct, and I just would sit in her apartment, observing her. I started asking for things to do, and she gave me menial tasks, like carrying boxes and things, and putting up flyers for meetings. And eventually, I graduated from law school, got my degree, and she put me to other work. We started taking on the slumlord, and eventually the slumlord got convicted in federal court. We had battles and adventures, but watching this woman, I found out that hope was something different than I had ever thought it was. Hope is not optimism and just cheery, positive thinking. No way. She defined hope to me in a different way than I'd ever thought about. For her, hope was seeing the wretchedness of the world. Her son was murdered in the buildings in 1980. Served in the American military, came home to visit, was around the neighborhood in the lobby of the building I would eventually move into. He was murdered. For her, hope wasn't trying to pretend bad things don't happen. She knew they did. It's not being blind to the drug dealing and the crack house and the addiction. She knew all of that. But for her, hope did not exist in the abstract. It was relational to despair. It was a response to despair. Hope for her was never letting despair have the last word. This to me was important because for us in this country, there's a lot of issues that I hear this when we talk about race. It's like I hear Rodney King talk, like, why can't we just all get along? Without talking about the real racial realities, and in a way that doesn't put people in the defensive, doesn't make people feel blame. Life is not about blame, it's about all of us accepting responsibility and being willing to talk about the truths that exist. I sit in the Senate sometimes and I just wonder, why are we just waking up? Flint, Michigan is not an anomaly in America. There are towns in this all around the United States that are poisoned. We have Superfund sites in every single state in the nation, usually in poor communities, more often in brown communities, and we now have the data on Superfund sites that's chilling. Chilling. Children born within 3 miles of Superfund sites have a 20% higher rates of birth defects, 20% higher rates of autism. We have poison in our air that has urban kids, especially with rates of asthma that are, it's the number one reason why kids miss school in America. And not to be able to talk about these things as if we're not criticizing ourselves. Baldwin said, I love America. That's why I reserve the right to criticize her perpetually. And so what I think from my experiences is Miss Jones seemed to tell me over and over again that you can't be a great lover of this country without seeing the ugliness. You can't be a great lover of this country without having your heart be broken. You can't go beyond tolerance and be able to leave your comfort zone, reach out to folks, lead with love without getting crushed from time to time. Now, she was tough on me and she wouldn't let me give up. With the story that Senator Durbin tells, that I have a chapter on, I was elected to mayor of the city, to city council, and bad things happened. I thought I'd be elected to the city council and the government would change, but no. I started getting outvoted on the city council, 8-1. A lot. One of the senior council people said to me, boy, you got to learn to count to 5. We had 9 people on the council, 5 was a majority. He goes, you can't count to 5. You're not going to get anything done. And then the mayor of the city, I don't know how you all play it here in Evanston, you know, we play hard in Brick City. The mayor was like, my car was being ticketed where I parked with the other council people. I'd come out and there'd be tickets on my car. We found out, I'm not making this up, that my phones were being tapped in my office by the city police. I was being warned by cops that I was being followed everywhere I went. Don't do anything you wouldn't want to be seen by the mayor. I started getting frustrated. I was getting nothing done. Why did I run for office? And as Senator Durbin said, I then get a woman calling me up on one of my lowest days, feeling beat down, feeling frustrated, feeling like, why did I get into politics? And she starts yelling at me about Garden Spires and something happening. And she says, you gotta help us. And I go, how can I help you? She goes, maybe get the police out here. I said, I can't get the police. I'll stop ticketing my car. And we start yelling at each other. And before you know it, we're hanging up on each other. She said something that hurt me. Why did we elect you anyway if you can't help us? And I disrespected her. I yelled and I hung up the phone and I left City Hall and I'm going back where I'm living now in the projects with Ms. Jones. And I'm walking there. You know those days where you just don't want to talk to anybody. I just wanted to get to my apartment as quick as possible and sit down in a sensual embrace with two men that I love, Ben and Jerry. And I'm running to my, I'm coming up the, and then when I see Brick Towers, who is standing there on the steps like a sentinel? Is Ms. Jones. I begin to do geometry like I never did it before. What vector can I take to get in those buildings without having to talk to that woman? And I try to get through, but this woman has got hawk eyes. And I was like a little field mouse, and her talons came out. And so I try to walk past with her, and she's like, and she says those words. You have to respect what an elder says to me. Don't you walk past me. I stop. And she could sense me. She has the sixth sense. She sees the mood, and she knows just how to play me. She goes, come over here and give Miss Jones a hug. And I did not want to hug anybody. But I go over, and I hug her in the most insincere way possible. And then as I pull away, she grabs me by the arm, and she goes, tell me what's wrong. And that was it. She pushed the button. She wasn't going to be happy with it, but I let loose on this woman. Why did I get into politics? I was this lawyer getting things done before. Now I'm a city councilman getting nothing accomplished. And then I just let her have it. And Miss Elaine Sewell called me up and I yelled at her and I hung up at her because they're having problems up at Garden Spires. And I'm whining like I was 5 years old to her. And I'm like, there's drug dealing and there's violence out there and I don't know what to do. And I must have repeated that 6 or 7 times. I don't know what to do. And probably on the 6th time she interrupts me and she goes, oh my gosh. I'm like, what, Miss Jones? And she looked like God had spoke to her. She's like, I know what you should do. And I'm like, what? And she rolls up like this and she's like, yeah, I know what you should do. And I'm like, I heard you. Tell me. And then she's like, yeah, I know exactly what you should do. And I'm like, Miss Jones, I don't have time to play. Tell me what I should do. And so she leans in, and again, this is a brilliant woman. Sometimes she has incredible ideas, and she leans in, and I lean in, and she gets talking all soft, and so I'm trying to listen. And she goes, you should do, and I'm like, yes, what should I do? She goes, you should do. I'm like, yes, tell me. She's like, you should do something. I'm like, that's it? She goes, yeah, do something. And I wheeled around from this woman and I marched towards my elevators. And by the way, God has dominion over the earth everywhere except for public housing elevators because the devil owns those things. Because I'm so ticked off when the elevators were broken. So I march up 16 flights of stairs. I sit down on my desk and I'm so angry. That woman. And then I flip open the Bible and this passage, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed. Somebody yelled it out. I feel like I'm in church now. Who yelled it out? Faith the size of a mustard seed, what can you do? Move mountains. And I'm thinking to myself, and then most people don't know the next passage. It talks about, but sometimes you gotta fast and pray. And I look at that and I think about her and I think about it and I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna do something. So I called up my staff members. I said, we're going to get a tent and we're going to go out to Garden Spires. And I write in the book, my staff member who's grew up in Newark, he's like, no. And I'm like, I'm in charge. I'm the boss. Yes. And so we argue and debate. And finally we build a tent. We get a tent out there. And I went out to the spires and I see Elaine Sewell. And this is the power. I had disrespected this woman. And I walk up and I start to apologize. But before I can even get into my apology, she's hugging me. It's grace that she extended me. I did something we politicians do really good next. If you're going to be a politician, write this down. You got to learn to do this. I called the press conference. And I say to the press, I said, this is the United States of America. How can we have people living in fear in their own communities? We set up this tent, and I go on my hunger strike, and within less than 24 hours, that night we went to bed, and you can read about it in the book, it was a scary night the first night. I thought I might have made mistakes. Some people weren't happy I was there. They were throwing everything on top of the tent. Creative stuff. Used diapers came down on their tent. But the next morning, these big guys come out, and they were correctional officers, and they said, are you Cory Booker? And I said, yeah. They said, well, we heard you're staying out here. You're not staying out here alone. We're going to stand with you. Before you knew it, residents from other neighborhoods were coming out. Before we knew it, we had a whole bunch of folks coming from all over the place. Before you knew it, we had businesses coming to do job fairs. We had health screenings coming out, hospitals coming out to do health screenings. Suburban mayors from affluent town. This one mayor came down, brought food and police officers, which was really nice, but I was on a hunger strike and I couldn't eat the food. The 10th day of this hunger strike, the newspapers, press was coming out. They were beating up on the mayor of the city, and he shows up, my adversary. But I tell you something, when you fast and pray for 10 days, you see people for who they are. I didn't see him with hate or anger or bitterness. I saw him as another American on a journey. He came in and the paper, I put the clippings in, and in fact, one of the pictures in the book is this picture of this moment where I tell the people that this is our mayor. And we need to support our mayor. He's here now. And I said things about him, and he comes up to me, and we hug each other. I had never touched this man before more than a handshake. And now I'm hugging him. And I say this, we know we're in a political context where human connection is vilified, as Chris Christie was yelled about for hugging Barack Obama after a natural disaster. But this is what got me. My editor tried to take this out of the book, and I insisted that it be put in, because when I hugged him, it may sound weird, I'm hugging him and I'm breathing deep and I smell him. And I remember being so taken by the fact that he smelled like the elder African-American men in my family. That this man too was my family. He made announcements and said he was gonna bring police out there, he was gonna build a park. It was a big victory, but I don't wanna lie to you. He didn't keep his promises. They never built the park. The police stayed out there for a while. People had peace, but you all know this. The police eventually left, and what happened? Drug dealing came back. I eventually became mayor, and one of the first things I did was build the park. But I tell you the story to tell you that we underestimate the impact we can have. That final prayer I had when I sat there with over 200 people praying, and there were believers and non-believers, there were Muslims, Christians, Jews, people praying in Spanish and Arabic and English and Hebrew, a week for 10 days, and it was the strongest I had ever felt. But I want to end with an even more honest note. Because, as I said before, this is not the easy way to go. To stay, to never surrender to cynicism, to always try to do what my dad did, which he said, son, there's two ways to go through life. Be a thermometer or be a thermostat. Now, the thermometers just reflect the world. If somebody's being mean to you, you're mean to them. You're loading luggage on the overhead and everybody's pushing around, you get your temperature goes up. But he called on me to be a thermostat, to be somebody who tries to set the temperature, to be relentlessly kind, especially be kind to unkind people because they really need it. But I want you to know, I write in this book that I am not the model of this behavior. I'll end with this story. I've made the mistakes over and over again that I criticize or try to talk about in the book. One of the mistakes I've made is that I think that sometimes it's the big battle. If Senator Durbin's legislation gets passed, it's going to help thousands and thousands of people. And I'm so annoying to him because I'm so invested in these negotiations that are going on right now. We get caught up in the big fight and the big battle, but we forget. We forget. I was a guy who lived in these projects now for 8 years with Miss Jones, and I watched kids grow up, and I'll tell you, I would come home and see these boys become young men, teenagers, high school students, and I lost the mayor's race in 2002, and here it was now 2005, before the 2006 election, and I'd seen these kids who were children, and it's all, you guys know this with kids, you blink your eyes, the next thing they were young men. And I would walk into the lobby of my building and I would smell marijuana. It smelled like Stanford's campus sometimes felt. But you and I both know that the margin for error for a Stanford student smoking pot is different than the margin of error of a kid in inner city Newark. And I started seeing gang tags, which made me worry that they weren't just smoking pot, but probably selling it as well. And so knowing all the data I know and knowing the risks, I started saying to those guys, realizing, hey, they're on my doorstep, I gotta do something about this, and I started intervening. The mayor's race is coming, but I'm gonna try really hard. And I said, guys, hey, I always talk to you when I come home late at night, why don't we do something, why don't we hang out? And I said, fellas, let's go to a movie, any movie you want. And I thought they wanted to go see this home improvement movie, something really wholesome, because it was about tools. And they went, they said that they wanted to go see Saw 2. And I was like, no. But I took them out to dinner. I brought friends of mine who had been involved in the drug trade and got them to come out and talk to them about how their lives got turned upside. It was constructive conversations. Mentor projects started going, but then I had to drop it all. Why? Why did I drop it all? Because I was running for mayor. This is the big job. This is my dream. This is my biggest fight. I lost in 2002. I'm not losing in 2006. I'm gonna be the mayor. And yeah, these kids are important, but I'm gonna be able to help kids all over the city. And so I stopped following through, but the kids didn't leave. They were always there in my lobby. And on some days coming home from 24-hour campaignings, I was so busy going for that brass ring. But these kids, they helped me. I'd come home tired and they would be joking with me, lifting me up, telling me they had my back. They were gonna get everybody to vote for me, they said. One day I come home on one of the toughest nights, I open the door to the lobby, and these kids had like formed a parade line for me with lawn signs. They were all holding them up, Cory Booker, and they were chanting my name and my job, Mayor Cory Booker. And I'm like, now, suddenly I'm tired, but now I'm propped up. I've got a little bit of a swagger. I think it might have been my George Jefferson version. And now I'm just doing the parade line, like I'm really cool. The elevators are working. Devil had taken a holiday. And I go in the elevator doors and they close and I'm just so happy. I don't know if the elevator might not have been working because I was rising up. The kids had lifted me so much until I thought to myself, where'd they get those lawn signs from? Congresswoman knows they're expensive. Were they walking home and just picking them up? I'm sorry, man, this, campaigns are tough. Every penny counts. I win the mayor's race. I'm the mayor of Newark, New Jersey. I've got the big brass ring. I'm important now. I have power to do great good. But immediately I got death threats. FBI warned us. I wasn't even sworn in yet. And so they put security in our building, the most safest the project had ever been. They put posted security in my lobby. Posted security in my lobby. Now, I don't care who you are. Remember when you were a teenager? You would not want to hang out in a lobby with police officers. So the kids, I didn't see them, but hey, I'm so busy now, getting ready to be sworn in, I barely noticed that my fellas aren't hanging out in the lobby anymore. These kids were amazing young men. I remember them. I could name them. One of them was just like my dad, charismatic, funny sense of humor, used to tease me like my dad did. Hassan Washington, he lived with his grandmother just like my dad did. And they weren't there, but I'm not thinking about them because I'm trying to fight the city's big battles. Every time there was a shooting, I would go to the shooting. I was running around the city doing street level sermons. I would stand there when people crowd around and say, this is not who we are. We're Newark, New Jersey. We're gonna rise above this. I was working 24 hours, coming home one day, a few weeks after getting elected, a handful of weeks after getting elected, I get called to a street corner I still remember exactly where it was. Court Street, right up from our Main Street, Broad Street, shooting, two men shot, one with a sheet covered over, dead, the other one being loaded into the ambulance. I don't even pay attention to the bodies on the ground. I don't think to affirm their humanity. I don't ask their names. I'm too busy attending to the living. It was in front of a senior citizen building, people coming out. I'm going up to them and saying, we are going to rise above this. I'm talking to them. I'm giving my card out. Call me. We're going to do something. I get home after a long day to steal a few hours of sleep. I sit down on my bed and I pull out my BlackBerry and I'm going through the day's reports. I see the police report. I see homicide. See the kid's name. Hassan Washington, from my lobby, four floors below me, living with his grandmother. God had put this kid right in front of me every day. They didn't let my father fail. They didn't let my father fail. I start this chapter in the book with the worst of it. I started by talking about this Perry's funeral home in Newark. I've been to that funeral home in unnatural ways to see children put in boxes too many times, and it's all on one floor except for one room is in the basement. I gotta suspect it's the cheapest one because it is not the most pleasant room. I used to hate going there, and now I'm going there for Hassan's wake and funeral, And going into that basement is like, it's like descending into the bowels of a boat. It's narrow stairway going down. And there in that room, we were chained together in grief, piled one on top of the other in sadness, moaning and crying with another child in the box. And I was the mayor of the city, but I did not feel like it. I felt weak and impotent. I felt like a failure, and I just had begun, and I couldn't be the mayor. I couldn't hug people and comfort people. All I could do was stand in the back of that room, and when people came to me to hug me, I held them. I leaned on their light, and finally, I couldn't handle it anymore. The guilt and the shame, I just left. I ran. I told the cop who was now assigned to me, we're leaving. I stormed up the steps into this brand new SUV, had him fly down to City Hall. I ran into City Hall, didn't get in the elevator. I didn't want to see anybody. Sprinted up the steps into the mayor's office, this plush new office, spacious. I slammed the door and I sat on my couch, and all I could do was cry and think to myself, we were all there for his death. But where were we for his life? And here I was. Was I honoring his legacy, my father's legacy? Was I paying back the people who, but for their interventions, but for their kindness, I would not be the mayor, I would not be a senator, I would not have come into being? If you love, you will have your heart broken. You will feel pain and shame. You leave your comfort zone and you're going to get hit. I promise you that. And the question is how will you then define courage? How will you hew hope? Courage is not, I'm sorry, it's not the battle cry, it's not the big mayoral campaign speech. Courage is most often that little small voice when you feel like quitting and giving up, when just breathing takes effort, when you lie in your bed and courage tells you just put those feet on the floor, get dressed, and go back outside for another day of loving. So if I'm going to leave you with the final message, it gets back to that woman, Miss Virginia Jones, because she saw me and watched me even when I didn't know she was watching me. I went back and interviewed people about her. She's passed away now, and people told me, I still remember interviewing the tenant leaders, and they said, they laughed at me when I told the story the way I told it to you. They said, Cory, what you don't know is you show up at her doorstep, she's got no time for you, gruff and rough, and you walked away. She came to us and said, my son just moved into the neighborhood. I interviewed drug dealers, guys talking about shooting me. One guy said, who had some awful things to say about me when I first arrived, said Miss Jones went down to them and said, "You leave him alone. He's family." Coming downstairs from being broken, child's death. Get up early in the morning, and I'm 100 feet underwater. I walk through the lobby of my building, and I want to get out early. I don't want to see anybody. And I walk through the lobby of the building, and I realize this is the lobby where Miss Jones's son got killed. And she's still the president. I was so angry and bitter at this country. I felt, how could we swear a pledge allegiance to the flag and say we pledge ourselves to liberty and justice for all, but yet this goes on? I was ready to be just torn up inside, and that lobby made me stop and think. And then I get into the courtyard, and there's only one other person in the courtyard early in the morning. Her back is turned to me. It's Miss Jones. And I stop and I stare at her for what seemed like a long time. And then, almost as if she heard my thoughts wrestling, she turns around and our eyes connect. She did what she's done before. But this time, I wanted nothing more than this. She opens her arms up. And I took that invitation. I scurried over to her. I'm like, "Look, I'm 6'3". This woman's 5 feet tall, but when she hugged me, I felt like a little boy disappearing in my mother's arms, and I let loose. I start crying. And she rubs my shoulder and rubs my back, and she says two words over and over again, what I want to leave you with. Two words she says as she's rubbing my back, as resurrecting my spirit, saying these two words. And I'm telling you now, I say these two words to me all the time. I said them through my mayoralty, these two words. When things got tough, when my heart got broke, I say them in the United States Senate now, when I feel like I'm banging my head against a brick wall that will not move. I say them when I talk to people that I see, they don't think they even care or to know about the struggles of other Americans. I repeat these words, and it's not about religion. This words is about our thoughts about who we are. It's about our nation. And she just said two words that I so needed to hear. She rubbed my back. She said it over and over again. She said, "Stay faithful. Stay faithful. Stay faithful. We are Americans. We've come this far by faith. Perfect ideals put forth in an imperfect world, and it is our faith that has brought us a mighty long way. We cannot surrender to cynicism now. We must take responsibility, not blame some elected official or someone running for office for the divisions in our country. We have to take responsibility, evidence our power, create new cords of connection that repair the fabric of our country. And if we live with this kind of faith, I tell you this with great confidence, as great as our past was, our tomorrows will be more glorious than anything we've ever known." Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much. Thank you.